surround us with your favor, O Lord. The earth is full of your goodness. The earth is filled with your love. In your presence there is fullness of joy.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You may be seated. We're here to honor the memory, life, and legacy of Dolores, Candy, and Packett, my friend and your friend. Later on in the, we will ask a few of you to make share something about Candy, and we don't know who you are. The family will do that, will come, but also, but if you have a real, we have a certain time set aside for that, all right? So give some thought to that. And we're going to pray, and we'll hear.
Praise the Lord. Let us pray. Our great God in heaven, the God of all comfort, the God of all peace, the God of all love, the God of all goodness, and the God of all mercy. We thank you, Lord God, that you have blessed us to assemble here today to celebrate the life and the legacy of Dolores Candy Packett. Father God, you said in your word that you came that we might have right to life and have it more abundantly. And we thank you that she had an abundant life on this earth. We thank you that she had a prosperous life on this earth. We thank you, Father God, that she had a richness of family and a richness of friends. Father God, we thank you for the lives that she touched while here on this earth. We thank you that your word declares to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, which is a far more better place. So we thank you that she's in your presence today. We thank you, Lord God, that your word declares in the name of Jesus that the grave has no victory. death has no sting. That death has been swallowed up in victory. That the transformation has taken place. So we thank you, dear Lord God, that she had the boldness and the confidence when she knew she had done all and labored here in this earth. She gave us notice that she was going to the other side. And so we thank you today that she's on the other side, that she's with the Father. So we thank you, Lord God, as we celebrate her life today, that we remember the precious memories, that we will take hold of them and remember her in the days ahead, that they will give us joy and that they will give us peace, and that we, as we hear the word of God through the eulogy, we will understand what has taken place here, that death didn't have any victory, but she laid her life down. So we thank you, Lord God, in the mighty name of Jesus. We give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Cherished memories of our dear, wonderful, loving friend. A lovely lady, a woman of wisdom, and a faithful friend. I will be reading passages from the Old Testament, Psalms chapter 37, verse 21 to 27, from the New King James Version. As you all can see, the air conditioning is working in my favor. But I'm not going to have these things blow all over in your faces. Praise the Lord. All righty. Now, see, Candy would have laughed at that. Praise the Lord. Okay. Oh, to God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Oh, goodness gracious. Psalm chapter 37, verses 21 to 27. The wicked borrow and does not repay, but the righteous shows mercy and gives. For those blessed by him shall inherit the earth, but those cursed by him shall be cut off. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. And though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholds him with his hand. I have been young, and now I am old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed, his descendants, begging bread. He is ever merciful and lends, and his descendants are blessed. Depart from evil and do good and dwell forevermore. And now for our New Testament passage taken from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 to 9. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again I say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will keep and guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of a good report, if there is any virtue, if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do. And the God of peace will be with you always. Thus is the reading of the Word of God, and He has already blessed His Word, and may our hearts be also blessed and comforted with His Word.
As we it's a bit quiet in here. Candy called me. Kim was there. Candy thought she was going to die, and Kim called me, and Candy said, Mom wants to talk to you. And I said, okay. And she said, and Candy got on the phone, she said, Walter, take me down a little bit. She said, Walter, my funeral is going to be at your church. I said, yeah, okay. She said, I don't know where I'm going to be buried. That's left up to the children. That's their problem. And I have everything else worked out. So I want to say that to you to let you know you may as well relax. Because Candy would come here and we would sit right there. And then when our children were young, she'd sit right over there. And she'd sit with them and she'd have a hat on and she was just as quiet. You wouldn't know Candy was in the building, but she would just sit there and she'd come and she'd be with us. And of course, then the rest of it's history. After Mr. Packett passed, we would go on vacation. We said, well, we're going to go on vacation, Candy. And would you like to go with us? We didn't know what she would say at the time. And she said, she would always pause, think for a moment. Yeah. And that started our traveling. So we're here to rejoice with her life. And with all of you being here, this is what it's about. It's about Candy. This is a lady who's 92 years old. And to have a service like this is saying something about her. So relax. We're going to have some fun. She didn't want a sad occasion. She said she wanted everybody dressed up colorfully. The hats, if you see hats around, you see Candy's hats. Everything is cats, and I've known her 36 years. So now it's her favorite song. I think she would perhaps with Jack when it was whatever the song is their song. So we're going to stand here while we listen to Candy's song. Well, no, we'll let her Candy. All right, we're going to sit. Will you play that more? It's her favorite, and then we will.
Their wedding song.
And so and enjoy it. The words will be on the screen, I think. Are we ready? Let's go.
Love the world has known. This is the love I'll give to you. love you more. I know I never lived before, and my heart is very sure. No one else could love me more.
For those of you who have friends, you can just plug in Christ Community Lakeland, and all of your friends can watch the services live right now, and they'll be online just after the service. It'll be 24 hours, but immediately. So just Christ Community Lakeland, find it, and they can all watch it. All right. It's very quiet in here. There's echo up here. It's quiet in here, but we don't like quiet. She said, my funeral is going to be at your church. All right.
One simple but brilliant trick to heat your home in 90 seconds and save that.
Reflections. Family and friends, in any order.
Tag on real quick to what Walt was saying about her. My funeral's going to be at your place. Mother also, very efficient. I was in the hospital with her. It was just she and I. And she's like, well, you know I want to be cremated. I was like, yes, Mother, I know. She goes, well, you need to call the funeral parlor and let's find out about that. All right. So we called Heath, because Heath is who took care of Dad. And I had the speakerphone on, and the lady answers, the same lady that took care of Dad. And I said, hi, and I introduced myself, my mom. I says, you know, we're interested in, you know, the cremation, what all goes on about it. And she goes, oh, okay, and she starts to talk about it. And mom pops in, and she goes, when's your next available appointment? I was like, Mom, you don't really make appointments for cremation. And she's like, okay. And the lady, you could tell, was obviously speechless. And she said, well... And she proceeded, I said, no, just tell me about what the, you know, want to know about the cost and everything. And she starts talking, and mom's like, well, what about next Tuesday or Wednesday? Mom, you don't make appointments for cremation. And so I told the lady, I said, look, we'll just call you back. Oddly, it was the following Tuesday. Oh, one other thing, the lady said, well, you know, mom's like, well, what's the process? And she says, well, after you pass, we come and get the body, and 5 to 7 days later, and she goes, oh, so do I stay at a hotel, or where do I stay for those 5 to 7 days? At that point, I knew I had to hang up real quick before the poor lady at the funeral home totally lost it. In any event, so Mother sure did have a good long run, and she lived a very full life with no regrets, and she did a lot of things in her 92 years. She was a world traveler and filled all of us with the travel bug. Going through photos was like going through a travelogue from around the world. In her younger days, she was even on the old show, What's My Line? She was always a hard worker and hustled. I've always said she is where I get my feisty from. She was an entrepreneur before there even was the term entrepreneur. She took off to New York from Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania without a plan to see if she could make more money there. She never shied away from work, no matter what kind it was, and was very astute at jumping on opportunities. She worked as a photographer, which led her to a stint as a salesperson for American Kosher selling salami in Miami. While working for them, she was at a public store set where she met Jack Packett. I've always said the best thing Mother ever did for me was to marry Jack Packett. He truly was the best dad ever. She came to Lakeland, and while she was here, her brother Tony was visiting, and she made a deal with her brother Tony. And they both took a real estate class. The rest of that story is legend in Lakeland. I don't think I have to go into how successful she was on that. She was also known to play a bit of tennis. She was always up for a thrill. She got her pilot license. She went rafting on the Snake River. She went parasailing. Lots of helicopter rides, ballooning, travel. Oh my goodness, lots of travel. 3 trips this past summer, Hawaii, Jamaica, and Italy. Always looking for different places to go and adventures to be on. Yes, she did a lot in her life. About 30 years ago, she started playing bridge. She loved bridge and her bridge community. The second best thing Mother ever did for me was introduce me to her beloved bridge community. For the past 3 years, I've had the opportunity to be her bridge partner 3 times per week, every week. That has been an adventure. Now, let me share a little bit about bridge with you. Oops, sorry. I had taken lessons in Minnesota and learned what I will refer to as proper bridge. Mother did not play proper bridge. There are bridge conventions and rules. When you play, you need to, for instance, declare the conventions you play, like transfers, strong two bids, stamen, etc. When asked what conventions she played, she would always respond, "I play gut bridge." Conventions and rules were optional to her. She was not good at following them. For instance, when playing bridge, the other players are allowed to ask, "What does that bid mean to you?" When Mother would bid one of her crazy bids, they would look at me and ask, "What does that bid mean to you?" I would have to say, "I have no idea. It could mean this or this or this. I'm winging it." Sometimes she would bid so high, and I would have to play that hand, and she would say, "Oh, I know you can do it." Then she would lay down her cards and have like 3 points. She always did challenge me. That's a picture of how she did life. Wing and a prayer, gut instinct, on a whim. Rules are optional. And she was very lucky. By the way, she could pull out amazing bridge hands and the craziest bids and make them. Another thing she did when Tim and I moved here 3 years ago to help her out, she got used to us always holding hands when we said grace over every meal. To the point when we would sit down and eat, she would be the first to hold hands and say, "Are you going to say grace?" It was very sweet. She really did do so much in her life. With all that she did in her life, there was one thing in particular that was the most important thing she ever did. It was a decision she made later in life, something she did that was a game changer for where we are at right now. The single most important thing she did was when she accepted Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. Thank you to Paul and Margie, who first prayed with her and so many years ago to accept Jesus. Thank you also to the friends who prayed with her in her final days. I also got to pray with her. She was at peace when she left us to be welcomed by Jesus in heaven. Even though she did a lot of good works, donated to a lot of charities, that has nothing to do with where she will spend eternity. It's not by works. So yes, you need to verbally proclaim your belief that Jesus is your Lord, that he is the Son of God come to earth, died on the cross as payment for your sins, rose on the 3rd day, defeating death. He is risen, and we are saved and will be with him in heaven. You see, as Christians, we grieve differently than the world does. For us, it's not goodbye. It's see you later. To grieve when you have not accepted Jesus as your Lord, you grieve a great loss in your life here on the world. As Christians, we know our bodies die, but our soul and spirit live in eternity. So while we weep, we also celebrate. We have sorrow and hope. For those who say, "I know there's some kind of afterlife," that's very true. Know there's a choice you have the opportunity to make as to which afterlife you get to experience. As for me and my husband, Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. We are secure in the fact that we will see her, my dad, my grandma, and many others when we transition to heaven. If you're not 100% sure and you'd like to talk to me or pray with me, please feel free to reach out. I'll be happy to talk with you and pray with you. So yes, she did pack a lot into her 92 years on earth. She had a great run here and touched many, many people. Let us remember the single most important thing she did, and with that, celebrate her being born into eternity.
Thank you. lady, anyone else?
Hi, for those who don't know me, I'm Nevaeh DeLuca. Aunt Candy was my aunt. I wanted to start off by saying how this moment is something I didn't expect to come at all. I actually thought she might live like all of us, like she would forever. She is in a better place now, pain-free, hopefully, sitting at the beach with Uncle Jack with an ice cold tea in her hand. Most memories with Aunt Candy are spent on pool days, events at the ranch, and family gatherings. But there's one day I specifically remember. A few years back, she invited me to watch the Nutcracker with her at Florida Southern. With her, of course, I said yes. As much as I love Aunt Candy, driving is not her strong suit at all. But 13-year-old me didn't know that. She was so short, and the only thing you could see from outside the car is her hat, so you obviously could tell she couldn't see the road. Let me just say, there's not a small curb that didn't get hit. I said, Aunt Candy, are you sure you got this? She said, dear, I got this. I'm okay. I said, okay, you do your thing, Aunt Candy. Let me know if you need help. Next thing you know, we're hitting every curb. There's not one we passed that didn't get hit. Mind you, she's just trying to pull into a parking spot, not even on the road. But as much as she struggled, she hit it well and stuck to being the independent, strong woman she was. I can say for the whole room, she was a very loved and missed person. It was her time to go, and Uncle Jack missed her. Thank you.
I knew Miss Candy, Grandma
I,
Candy,
who are you?
Grandma. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Jessica. I'm nervous. I'm sorry. That's my dad, my mom. Sorry. So I've known Miss Candy probably my entire life, because she's known my dad 36 years. So I probably met her then and just, you know, didn't remember. But I remember her from when she became our realtor, and she would drag us every Saturday in her little car, and we'd all fit in the back seat, and we went probably visited about 20 homes every Saturday, and we just, that was my memory, my first memory of her. But as I grew up, I knew that she was just more than our realtor, and she was such a good individual inside out. And she made it her point to make time for you in the moment whenever she was with you and whenever you were spending time with her. And you never felt like she was in a hurry to do the next thing. She made time for you. And I remember 4 years ago, she said, you know, I love St. Armand Circle. She's like, have you been there? And I was like, I haven't. I know I'm in Sarasota all the time. And she's like, we need to start going, Jess. And we made a plan, and we would go on Saturdays to St. Armand Circle, and we'd shop. We'd go to the Columbia restaurant, and she had her rhythm and how she did things. And she was just such a very wonderful individual. And I just appreciate her, and I want to thank her and my dad and her family just for sharing her, because she was such a sweet individual. And she made time every day for me, my kids, you know, FaceTime weekly on a basis. And I know she was a busy woman, and she had a lot of family, and she had a lot of grandchildren, but I just wanted to say thank you for everything. And we're gonna miss you, Grandma. And from the bottom of my heart, I love you. I love you. And
lastly, okay. Thank you.
I'm just speaking on behalf of, as the oldest daughter of Walter and Carrie Laidler, who, as Jessica said, we've known Candy for a long time. So most of our childhood and early adult life, and we now have three sons, my husband and I, Darian, and they've grown to know her because of the time that she spent. She never had an issue spending time with anyone. I feel that she was so huge of a heart to ingratiate us with her presence and extend her love beyond her immediate and blood relatives for others who were not even in her family. And we really felt that love. We really felt the love from her and from Amy and from her family that allowed us to even be a part of your family. And I would like to also thank you all for being open to welcoming us into your family, because it just meant so much. As we have each other and our immediate family, but we've often been, I guess, adopted others as our family members and close friends, because we don't have a lot of close family around here in this town. So it's very heartwarming, and we very much appreciate it when we're seen as family, and we incorporate family into our family. So we just like to appreciate Ms. Packett and all of the family members. We used to spend lots of time at the pool, at her house, sitting on the back porch with Jack and her, and she would make us crystal light and fix crackers and punch and juice, and always ask about the kids, and she would always check me about the kids not calling her, and we would make sure we called her, and then we would spend time with her at her house. She was family. She was granny to us too, and we spent time, and probably, of course, you can always say we didn't spend enough time, but the time we spent was well spent, and it was very full. And we had a full life and time with Candy, and as I'm sure all of you have felt similarly to us. So we just wanted to say that and thank you so much.
All right, thank you. Here's another hat.
Good morning, everybody. My family and I met Miss Candy in 2014 through Bishop Walter, soon after we had arrived from Australia. Having left family, friends, work, and everything behind, Miss Candy adopted us as one of her own. Her family became our family, and her friends became our friends. I was given the honor and the privilege to be Mr. Jack's caregiver and also Miss Candy's caregiver during her last few weeks. In Mr. Jack's last few years, he used to call me Arabella after a princess in a book he had loved. During Miss Candy's last week, she said, "I'm going to call you Arabella," just like Jack did. I'm so glad they are together in heaven with Jesus. Miss Candy was a beautiful, loving, caring, and generous lady, a true blessing to me and my family. I would like to read a verse on friendship, Proverbs 27, verse 9, and it says, "The heart-filled counsel of a friend is as sweet as perfume and incense." Today, I'm thanking God for Miss Candy's life, love, and wise counsel. We love her and miss her tremendously. I will share her wise words she shared with me many, many times. Keep the faith, and it will all work out. Thank you, and God bless you all.
Alright, if that's it, we are going to, I would go to see. Yes, please. Juan, New York City. Tell us who you are and your parents.
Good morning. My name is Juan Galeano, and I'm here with my parents, Francisco and Dora. I was blessed to get to know Candy over 8 years ago when, after getting a lot of counsel from Walter, I decided to finally take a step into investing in real estate. And I had worked with a realtor who I felt wasn't giving me the best advice before. And Walter, after
I... Go on and tell it.
Okay. A house was being on the market for like 89K, and he encouraged me to, the previous realtor I was working with encouraged me to go above asking price at the time when it wasn't as competitive, and to go for 93K offer. And I thought that was, I really wanted to move forward. I was anxious, I was still learning. And I told Walter about it, all excited, because I, you know, was finally taking the first step. And Walter quickly let me know that I had over-offered and that I wasn't getting good advice and I need to reconsider, and so I did. And then he introduced me to Candy. And Candy was someone who really had a lot of patience. She had a lot of grace. She helped me, because I'm a little bit of an anxious person in general, and I felt like she really calmed me down, especially in the early stages of that time. So for me and my family, she was a huge blessing. She was a very proud Lakelander. Whenever I would call her, living in Indiana right now, she would always tell me about new things happening there. When I would come to visit, we would usually go to this one restaurant, Abuelas, and she told me about a new Mexican restaurant that she wanted to try out, and so we went there. So she was always just talking about how much she loved the city and was someone who was such a big lover of Lakeland. And for her and for my family and I, even my sister, Candy has blessed us tremendously. She gave us a chance, an opportunity when it would have been very hard to get any sort of conventional lending. And she has impacted our family for generations now. What was able to happen because of her accelerated anything we could do, having come from more humble beginnings. So for her, I'm forever grateful. She will always hold a special place in my family, and I thank her family for just supporting her and being able to do the things that she did. She would share different things about how important driving was to her, and that if that ever was lost, she gave me advice about what to find in a wedding partner and her criteria for when she was looking at like possibly marrying Jack and things that she thought about. So she's full of wisdom, and for us and our family, we love her, we're forever grateful for her, and she was a blessing for us. So, thank you.
And Francisco and Dora flew all the way from New York City to be here today.
I would simply like to say that for me and to me, Candy was the picture of the fruit of the Spirit. She was filled with love, and her love was so genuine, so freely given. She was filled with joy, and she always smiled. It reflected in her very countenance. And she always was so receptive, just loving and joyful and full of joy, because the joy of the Lord was in her life, and she appreciated life, and she loved life. And she brought peace wherever she was. There was a calmness and a serenity that Candy Packett just exuded out of her being. And even though things were around her might have been going haywire or whatever, but she always stood very, very strong. I remember Candy as being so meek. She received her celebrity status or whatever, but with humility. You would never know all of her accolades because she would not tell, she would not shout them from the rooftop, but rather if you happened to find out about it, then she would graciously just kind of nod her head, not even hardly to say thank you. She didn't even need you to necessarily thank her. And when she did something for you and you wanted to thank her and you couldn't thank her hardly enough because what she did was just so remarkable and so overwhelming, and she would just kind of let you know, that's enough, that's okay, you know. She was very patient. Very patient, yes. Now, my family declare that it was 95 houses that that she took us to. That's what they say. But anyway, it was probably very close to that. And you know something, Candy actually agreed with them. She just kind of, but with a smile and a chuckle. But she was just so patient and just full of long-suffering. She would just kind of, in her gracious way, and I'm going to just share this, we were going to sell our house when we lived just around the corner from the church on Sharon Circle. And all of a sudden, I got seller's remorse because at that time, it was just the three daughters and Walter and me. And there was a little dollhouse in the backyard, and I just thought, oh my goodness, what other house would have a dollhouse? This is just so perfect. We don't need to leave this place. We really need to just stay here. It's okay. And I had the audacity to say that to Candy. Candy, I'm not ready to move. Now, mind you, we had already signed the contract and we had already agreed. I hope that those potential purchasers are not in the audience today, because I need to ask you, I need to get on my knees and beg your forgiveness, but thank you for your understanding as well. But Candy she just said, okay. She said, you know, the buyers were ready. It was a cash offer. And I don't even know how I could have even thought that. But because of the way Candy handled it, I learned a very valuable lesson. I learned a lesson about integrity. I learned a lesson that around Candy, if you made a mistake, now you all know why Jessica is my daughter, the one with the red hat and who got very emotional. But I learned from Candy that if you made a mistake, you just pick yourself up and you go on. And at the end of her life, I asked Candy if she would forgive me, because I realized how foolish that must have looked like and how lack of business sense I had and I illustrated. But she was so precious. She was so precious. And I frankly, like you, Nevaeh, I really guess, thank you, sweetheart. Thank you, darling. Oh my goodness. Oh, you can see Candy in him, can't you? Her spirit is on you, darling. Thank you. But I guess I thought that Candy would live forever too, Nevaeh. You're not the only one. And I was not ready to release her. And I told her, and I said, Candy, we can fight this together. You don't have to go. You know, it's your will that's at work in this. And I took her a song entitled, "With God, All Things Are Possible." Nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible with God. And I played the song on the phone for her, and she listened. And I knew that it was an orchestral rendition, so I just knew that she would appreciate that. Well, she did appreciate the orchestral rendition, and she said, "This is a very nice song." But Candy's will was indeed at work, and she had said, "It's okay." She said, "It's all right. You know, I'm ready to go to the other side." I wasn't ready. But then when I did get the the text, and I got a phone call from Amy, and Amy had indicated that Candy did not want any more blood transfusions, and she was ready to go. And I went before the Lord, because that morning before I received that phone call, I was so uncontrollably emotional, almost like now. Isn't this terrible? But anyway, after I got a piece and I said, Lord, I'll release her because I know that that's what she wants. And it would be very selfish of me to not want to not be in agreement with what Candy wanted. And I received a piece and I was ready to release her. I know that she did go on home to be with the Lord, and I am so grateful for that. I'm so grateful that we all know, but we knew because of her life, because of her lifestyle. And she used to say, I don't know why the Lord has me living here so long, why the Lord's got me here. But we know, we all know why Candy stayed as long as she did. She was such a blessing to each and every one of us. And we don't necessarily know what she blessed each other with, because Candy operated in moderation, discretion, humility, and integrity. She did not let her right hand know what her left hand was doing. She just did what she felt was right, and she did what was good for everyone involved. God bless you for being here. I'm so glad to see all of you witnessing to her life and the love that she apparently showed you unselfishly. I sense it in this room because I know that she was so unselfish and so giving to us. To God be the glory, and thank you all again.
We might have to look up the family tree because I'll probably lose it too. I'm Trevor, Candy's broker. I'm terrible at these. It's hard for myself to stay together. But more importantly, before that, she was my friend and mentor. And I probably wouldn't be here today without her help. I remember she took me on her first, one of my first listings appointment. Walked around. Now, I've done all this training and things like that. And she's never met this woman before. And she lays the paperwork on the table. And she says, I'll do a good job for you. What else do you want me to tell you? And that lady just signed off the paper. I'm like, oh, so all those scripts and that, it is great. So, but you see a picture here. And there's a sign that we put out there that she's a forever realtor. And when people ask me what that means, I mean, Candy is the definition of that. I mean, she's generational. Like, oh, Candy, you know, you got a contract today. Well, that's the granddaughter of the family that I sold their house and their parents and parents. So to see that, you don't see that a lot in the real estate industry. She always, integrity, first and foremost. A lot of agents keep me up at night, but I never, not once, had to worry about Candy. Her paperwork might not be straight, but I knew she had it in a folder. Probably one of the last real estate agents that still handwrote in cursive, so they still need to teach it in school, in cursive, to this day, or not to this day, but and turned them in. She's helped mentor a lot of people. She's helped more people in our community than I've met. You know, she was so gracious. She didn't want the accolades, but I think today we need to realize what she really did. I don't think there's a person in this room that knows that Candy wasn't there for them if they needed, right? She walked around. I never seen her mad. We had some really crazy deals and never seen her mad, except if rent was late. If she had her all black on with a black hat and she was driving that black cat, I'm like, oh, Candy, who didn't pay rent this month? But that's all jokes aside. I used to say that, but she never did. She never did. But, you know, there's a lot of people that come in and out of our industry. And I've been with her since day one, whether it was Mid-Florida, Realty World, Berkshire Hathaway. You know, a lot of things changed, but Candy was the same. I tried wearing one of her hats today, but it didn't fit. So, but I just a testament of who she was and what she did in her community. I remember riding around. She has a story for almost every single house in Lakeland. I know that, you know, Barbara Bush used to party in that house, and I sold it and things like that. But she never, you wouldn't know that unless you knew her. So to get to know her as a friend and part of the family, and she never missed one of my birthdays. I mean, that says a lot. I know we're sad today, but let's be grateful that we got 92 years. And she taught us a lot. And don't forget those. I told you I was going to do it. So, you know, what would Candy do, right? So, you know, what would Candy do? And she also, there's some isms in there, and I told Brandon this the other day. Usually, Candy always tells me, your first offer is usually your best offer, so you might as well take it. So, but thank you to the family and everybody that's here today. I will miss her dearly.
I would visit Candy. You just don't know. Just briefly, 1987, the church is here. We looked at some land on 10th Street. I looked in the phone book, for those of you who know about phone books, they don't have it anymore. 36 years ago, and I said, well, I didn't know Realty either. So we looked at the first one in the phone book, AH Realty, and we called it. Saturday morning about 9 o'clock. Candy was, I guess, that day, Saturday serving part until noon, answered the phone. When things like this happen, people say, oh, God did it. Well, Jesus said, no one has ever seen him at any time. John 1:18. In John 5:35, it says, you have never heard his voice, nor have you ever talked to him face to face. But I have come to reveal God to you and tell you who he is. And so he said, now, through the works and the miracles and the signs that he did in his life and his death, burial, and resurrection, you cannot prove God exists because we cannot put God under a microscope, clone him, put him in a petri dish, and say, here's God. But whoever created God, where did he come from? Does God have a brother? Does he have a sister? Who is God's daddy? Does God have a brother? Who is God's children? Whoever created the heavens and the earth? We don't know. We have never seen him. But somebody had to create everything that you see. And we don't know who it is. Dr. Billy Graham says, well, when he's asked, well, who is God? He says, I don't know. It's a mystery. So God is a mystery, and no one has ever seen him. So whoever created the heavens and the earth, the sky, the hemisphere, the stratosphere, the water, the trees, we don't know. If you live in a house, there's a metaphor for describing God. We say he's the man upstairs. Okay, if you're in a two-story flat, it's fine. If you're a geologist, you say, well, he's, and you study rocks, you say, well, he's the rock. The rocks are so old. El Capitan or the Grand Canyon or whatever. He is so old, he's the rock of the ages. If you're in politics and we elect our powers that be, we will say, well, these are those who have been given power, constitutional authority. Well, then we will say, well, God is the higher power. In terms of old age, we will say, well, whoever God is, well, he is the Ancient of Days. And when it comes to the Bible, the people of the Bible said, well, who is God? They say, well, we don't know who he is, but whoever he is, we're going to call him God. And in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the writer of the Hebrews says, well, if you're going to come to this God whom you cannot see, you have never heard his voice, nor have you ever talked to him face to face, if you're going to come to God, you must believe that he exists. And he is a rewarder of those who will diligently seek him. Therefore, faith, being firmly persuaded with this idea of hope and certain expectation, coming to God and believing God exists is where faith comes in. So our faith, then, is in the Creator, whoever he is, who created the heavens and the earth. And Christ has come to reveal God to us. Jesus said, and when you all pray to God as our Father, you say, our Father. And once we accept the Creator as our Father, as our God, then through Christ we are brothers. No pun, but sisters, that there's no gender in terms of spiritual dimension. So then we are brothers, our Father, who art in heaven. Talking to Candy that day, she showed us the property. It was $56,000 across the street. That's about all we had. And we didn't have that. She said, but it's low over there. And I said, it is low, but that's all. We could afford $56,000. She said, well, that piece over there is for sale. I said, well, how much is it? She says, it's $170,000. It's 17 acres. But they just raised it to $230,000. So you could get that. I say, why would they raise it? She said, well, if it doesn't sell, you increase the price. We put a contract on it. Our church here floated bonds to get the first $100,000. It took 19 months for the bond program to initialize and then to sell the bonds and close the deal. By the time the Lake Gibson Church of the Nazarene, which is now Lake Gibson, this was Lakeside Church of the Nazarene, was here, now there, for them to move out by the time we take over the building. But we got the $100,000. Candy called me every Monday morning, between 7 o'clock and 7:15, on my way to work at Lakeland Highlands Middle School, every morning. If she missed it, I would be surprised. Walter, what's going on? I want to tell the owners what's going on with the bond program. I would say, well, nothing's going on. We got the prospectus and whatever. She'd say, okay, that's the one to find out. And Candy called me every Monday morning for 19 months. Just for about a minute. If that happened, from that, just many other things happen. So I have this question. Three questions are related to why you're here today. Number one, I'm going to ask you to stand when I ask you this question. I mean stand. I really mean stand. So get ready. That'll help you to shift the sand anyway. If you purchase property and Candy showed you the property as the listing agent or the buying agent, please stand. And I want all of you all to look around. They either showed you the property as the listing agent and the buying agent. All right. Thank you. You may be seated. I'm going to ask you another question. If you had a deal and the deal was about to go through and it almost fell through, and to keep it from going through, Candy helped you and pulled it through, please stand. Thank you. I have a third question. If you were served or if you were saved by Candy in some other way and she helped you in any other way that she helped you, please stand. Look around you. What I'm going to do is take a picture of this And I want to get a picture of this, and now I'm going to share. Thank you so much. I'm going to read my message because normally I would take a little longer. James chapter 2 and verse 1. My brethren, do not hold faith, the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with partiality. In other words, don't have bias in favor of one thing or a person compared to another. Then drop down to verse 2. I guess you say, well, what's the title of your message? The title of my message is, If You. If you were showed, if you were told by her, or if you served. So I'm going to use if. If you. James chapter 2 and verse 8. If you really fulfill the royal law of the scripture. Well, what is the royal law? You shall love your neighbor as yourself. You do well. Well, let me illustrate this for you. But if you show partiality, that is bias toward a person or a thing, you commit sin. Well, what is sin? Sin literally means taken from the artery. It just literally means to miss the mark. You just miss it. How many of y'all have missed it? We all miss it, okay? Now, the Pharisees called everybody sinners. The Pharisees called the people sinners. And they accused Jesus of fellowshipping and drinking with them, and you'd wine bibber and a glutton with these sinners. If you read carefully the text, Jesus never called anybody a sinner. Read it carefully. Look at the context. He didn't call anybody a sinner. And as convicted by the law as transgressors, verse 10, for whosoever shall keep the whole law, we're talking about we've all missed it, right? We agree? For whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point, he is guilty of all of the laws. Verse 11. For he who says, well, you shouldn't commit adultery, also said, do not murder. Here's the illustration. Now, if you do not commit adultery. The word adultery comes from the word adulterate, which means to water down, like bleach. You have to put it, you can't use bleach full force in your clothes, it'll eat them up. So you dilute it. So you adulterate, you water it down. Whether your commitment, your faith, your love. Candy had a strong commitment. Candy would basically, I would ask Candy a question. She would pause for a moment. I said, Candy, I don't know what you think about this. I said, Candy, I want you to tell me what you think about it. Well, Walt, well, what, whatever. Yeah. I said, listen, you have to pull it out of Candy. She will not. She told me years ago she was a talker. She said she used to talk a lot. And once someone told her, Candy, you just talk too much. And she said, from that day on, I began to work at being quiet. And so I don't know where she learned it or when did she learn along the way, but that's what she said. And so she wouldn't tell. I said, well, finally I would have to really pull it out of Candy. What would you think of this deal or what happened? And then she would tell me, well, and that only happened maybe 2 or 3 times in 36 years. She would let you make up your mind if you hurt yourself. She would not interfere in your life. She had her opinion, but she would not interfere. Not, that's the way I know Candy. Now, if you do not commit adultery, but you do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So, speak and so do as those who will be judged by the law of liberty, that is, to be free from oppressive restrictions imposed by some authority. Verse 13, for a judgment without mercy, and a lot of people give their opinions of you, and they have no mercy. Mercy is to get something that you don't know. Mercy means to get out of something that you shouldn't have got out of. Mercy means to get out of something that you should never have the chance to get out. You should stay in it, but you got out of it. That's mercy. Grace is to is the favor that comes to you. You got out of something. What is it? You got out of something that you shouldn't have. In reverse. So he says, so judgment is without mercy to the one who shows no mercy, and mercy triumphs over judgment. Verse 14, if you heard Candace say, listen to this, verse 14, well, what does it profit? What does it profit or advantage or increase of brethren? If some of you or someone like you would say, well, I have faith. See, this is where I want to get to today. Because Candy was not known, she was raised Catholic and how she was raised, but all that. But Candy was not in a church every Sunday. The Christians that I talked to are concerned about Candy's soul. Well, where's Candy going? Is Candy saved? Margie said, well, Candy, I'm witnessing to you. Candy, I don't want you to go to hell. Candy called Margie and said, well, Margie, I'm calling to let you know I'll be going in a few days. Well, where are you going, Candy? Well, I'm going to the other side, Candy said. I'm going to on the other side of the bridge. Margie said, well, where are you going? She said, when you're going, Tuesday or Wednesday, I'll be gone. She said, well, where are you going, Candy? She said, well, I'm going, then she asked Candy, well, are you going to heaven? She said, why not? She said, well, Candy, I don't want you to go to hell. She said, Margie said, Well, I don't want you to go ahead, but I'm going to miss you. I'm going to miss you so much, Candy. I'm going to miss you so much, Candy. You know, we've been friends, and it was just a wonderful time to hear that. And they sit there and joked and talked. This was on Saturday. And that was earlier than another time. But then 2 days before Candy passed, Candy was a bundle of energy talking, and Margie came in and talked, and they talked about everything. I mean, all day. Candy said, Walter, when I go, I'm not going to suffer. She said, but I don't know why I am living so long. I said, Candy, I do. The Lord has let you live a long time so you could help me do his will. She looked at me. She didn't say anything, but she looked at me. I said, I know why you're living. Because how many of y'all have been helped by Candy? You stood here and showed it. That lady, the family may not understand all this. They may not know about all this. But I said, well, Candy, to me, this is before, I said, listen, to me, we've done at least 50 or 60 deals with Candy. I said, well, why, Candy, do you, she'll loan you money, and she'll say, now, unless Candy will, she said, now, if I give you something, you can have it. But if I loan you something, you're going to pay me back. So that's the thing. And then you say, well, Candy, I'd like to get a piece of property over here. Would you be able to help me get this? And she said, she paused for a moment. She said, well, what are you going to use? In other words, collateral. And I found out that when you give folk things, you really don't help them a lot, but they have to do something to get something, and then they can use it to help themselves. And I said, well, why do you do this, Candy? Because to me, this is what I told Candy, to me now, you all don't know this church right here had a deal with Fifth Third Bank. We owe them $450,000. We paid it down to about $310,000, whatever. Fifth Third was kind of rough on us. It was kind of harsh. And we were down to about $300,000. But they didn't want a church loan anymore. And so I said, Candy, would you be able to loan us $300,000 to our church? She said, I said, I know your interest rate is always 10%. How many of y'all know about the 10%? It's 10%, okay? It's that. If you don't understand it yet, it's 10%. It's 10%. She said, Walter, would you help us out as a church? I know your rate is 10%. She said, well, what is the bank charging you? I said, 7. She paused. She paused. She said, okay. That's the only deal I got candy to budge off of 10%. That saved this church. Candy has touched lives here and outside these walls. I thought it like, I'm going to close on this. I thought it was like this. Biological paternity, when you have your sons, your daughters, and your children, there is this administration and supervision that's this caring and feeding and this responsibility, and there's this flesh and blood shall not inherit the kingdom of God. There's always some kind of animosity, some kind of consternation, some kind of friction going on in biological families. Do you all know about that? There's always something going on, some dysfunction. But I found out when you start doing business, in Luke chapter 19, verse 13 says, Jesus said, occupy until I come, do business until I come. That once you go into business with a person, number one, it tests your honesty, your punctuality, your responsibility, the law of use, respect for authority, your agreement to your word. Everything you think you are as a Christian is tested when you do business with people. And I found that over 36 years of doing, must have been 50, 60, or 70 deals with Candy. We made Candy a lot of money. Candy made us a lot of money. I said, Miss Packett, I said, well, why do you do this? I said, because for people who are just trying to change their lives, it's difficult. I said, what do you, and I was stuttering trying to find a way to say it. And she said, to give them a start. That's what Candy said. How many of y'all has she given a start? That's why we're here. For us. Whom she has given a start. For us, to me, I said, Candy, to me, it is as if you are an angel. Because she helped us and many other people do what they could not have done any other way. And the relationship forged through business is a different kind of a relationship from the family paternal, maternal, blood, marriage relationship. It's totally different. And you are here today because of Luke 19, verse 13, doing business until I come. And it has proven and tested the integrity, the character, the decency, the responsibility, the accountability. One day I got behind. I said, well, Candy, I can't pay you this month, but I can pay you, but it's going to be real strained. May I not pay you this month? And you better have an answer while you go. And let the interest continue to roll until next month. She'll pause. She always stop. She'll just wait. She'll let, I don't know if she's letting me squirm or what. She'll wait. And then she said, sure, Walter. If I've done it once, all I can tell you is that this lady, some of you all don't know the impact. As Joseph was sent, though his life started off rough, and his brothers sold him into slavery, and they had no appreciation for the vision he had for his life. At the end of his life, he said, you all meant it for harm, not you, but they meant it for harm. But God meant it for good. He sent me ahead of you all to provide for a posterity. And Candy was sent before, not only this family, but for your extended family to provide a way to help all of us see a brighter day. That's my tribute to Candy. I walked in the house one day. I said, she said, well, Walter, just stop by any time. Candy, y'all just stop by any time. I said, well, you're going to have your pajamas on in the morning. Just stop by any time. Well, just stop by any time. So I stopped. I always call. I just always call. So I walked in, and one day I had, I said, "Hey, Dad," I'm talking to Mr. Packett. "Hey, Dad," I thought I'd get, "How you doing?" He said, "Who are you?" He said, and other times we'd talk together, he said, "Yeah, you know what? The first thing I don't want to go on. I could go on and on about Candy. But I can tell you this, she was a blessing to a lot of people. I hope you appreciate it in the days to come. We are strangers, but we know your mom and your grandmama and your great-grandmama. We know her. So at the mouth of these many witnesses, they rise up and testify to the fact that your mom and your grandmama was greater than you might realize." Let the church say amen. Amen. I would go to Candy's house and I would say, "Well, Candy," she was in the chair in the recliner. I said, "I'm going to play the piano for you." She would say, "Okay." And I just played different things, "If Ever I Would Leave You," anything I could think of. And then one day I said, "Well, what do you want me to play?" She said, "Amazing Grace." 3 or 4 days later, I come. I said, "Well, I'm going to play." She was, going through this. And she told Amy, she wants you to play Amazing Grace. And every day I would come there for the last two and a half, three months, before she transitioned, I'd play Amazing Grace. So we're going to put that on the screen and we're going to sing Amazing Grace. And then we'll be closing. Is that all right? I'm going to just stand to your feet. F, the key of F, John. F, G, and then A flat. We'll be F up. Am I right?
The Lord, the Lord, the Lord. The Lord has promised good to me. He worked my hope secure.
Neighborhood and I turn off Howard Avenue onto Goff Lane. Before I turn on Long Palm to go to War Memorial Boulevard, I look down at the house. I would look down at the house. And I would see Candy for 20 years, every day, 2-3 times a day. And I go back down the street, I say, Candy, Candy, Candy. I would call Candy, Candy, how are you today? I don't need anything. I'm not begging. I'm not borrowing. I don't want anything. I just want to find out how you doing. 2-3 times a week, I'd call Candy. A day will go by, and the next day, Candy will say, Walter, I haven't heard from you today. How you doing? We were in Hong Kong 2 days before, 3 days before the Wuhan virus, the coronavirus broke out. Candy called me. Walter, Bill and Sharon were there, and Karen and I were there. Walter, how are you doing? I said, oh, we're fine. I'm looking over the Chinese New Year, the dragons down below on the from the 21st, 27th floor, whatever it was. She said, are you okay? I said, yes. She said, are you sure? I said, yes. What's going on? She said, I just want to find out if you're doing all right. Candy was like that. She said, well, if I can help you, let me know. 2 days later, we didn't know. Then I started looking at TV. And we got out 2 days before President Trump closed the border. But Candy was an interesting lady. She didn't want you to say thank you. She didn't want you to just give her no praise. She just said, I would try to say something. We have Miss Packett visiting with us this morning. Don't mention it. So I hope you appreciated her. I love Miss Packett. I asked her one day, will you be my mom? You know, it's that kind of thing. So for us here at Christ Community, she's our friend. She's really our friend. For all of you whom she's helped, the Gallianos, and everybody, all who I don't know, who all of you stood, she was a friend. As a matter of fact, Jesus said, make friends with that unrighteous mammon that you got. And she did just that. I'm going to pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the life, the legacy, even the ministry, and the anointing and the gift of Candy in our lives. That you have used almost as if it's as if she were an angel to assist all of us along our way and to encourage us on our journey. Thank you for her life. Thank you for her family. We thank you that the blessing is on the family and that the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace is maintained in this family through the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank you for the testimony to the presence of all these people here today, to the life of Candy, that she has touched them very deeply. And for this, we thank you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
Say amen again.
Amen.
And say it again one more time. Amen. Amen. Thank you. And you are dismissed. You may greet the family down here if you will. Just you can talk to the family if you wish, if you haven't done so already. And then we'll dismiss you finally. Thank you all so very much. Have a good day.